Welcome to EconTalk, part of the Library of Economics and Liberty. I'm your host, Russ Roberts of George Mason University and Stanford University's Hoover Institution. Our website is econtalk.org, where you can subscribe, find other episodes, comment on this podcast, and find links and other information related to today's conversation. Our email address is mail@econtalk.org. We'd love to hear from you. Today is March 11th, 2011, and my guest is Diane Coyle. Her latest book is The Economics of Enough: How to Run the Economy as If the Future Matters. Diane, welcome back to EconTalk.
It's great to be here talking to you. Hi.
Your book discusses the major challenges facing the world right now. They're economic and some not so economic, but they all involved economics. What are those challenges? And then we'll talk about what we might do about them.
The trigger for writing the book, as so many books recently, was actually the financial crisis, which was a real shock to me, as to many other people. And the moment when I was most appalled by what was going on was when I listened to the news about the interbank market drying up, and I thought, you know what, the payment system might stop working too if the banks don't trust each other. I'd better go and get all the cash I possibly can. And for our economies to have got to that point, that was a pretty serious crisis. But as I reflected on that, I thought, you know, there are some other pretty serious crises too. We have the issue of climate change, and the science there is contested, but I think scientific consensus opinion is that it's a pretty serious problem, but lots of disagreement about what to do about it. There are crises related to our societies as well, particularly in the United States and the United Kingdom, inequality, with a lot of people arguing that it's got to really quite an extreme point and is socially unsustainable. We have a longer-burn financial crisis that's linked to the way we've structured our societies in the promise to pay pensions and welfare and support through public services, aging populations. This is an area where the U.S. isn't quite so badly off as some other Western economies, but in countries like Germany and Italy, for example, the fiscal position is completely unsustainable, and that debt just isn't spoken about. And as I pondered these questions, going to the cash machine to get at the ATM to get out as much cash as I could at the time, I thought that there was actually probably a common link between all of them, which was that perhaps we'd gone wrong in how we weighed up benefits today versus benefits tomorrow, and we weren't as good at thinking about the long term as we ought to be, and evaluating how serious problems might be over a much longer time frame. And that then takes you into questions of politics as well. So I guess I'd say this is a book of political economy rather than straight economics.
That central issue, let's talk about that as a starter. This worry that I think many people have, that we don't pay enough attention to the future and we focus too much on the present. Now, I have four children. Do you have children?
I've got two.
Okay, so I think about them a lot as a parent. I focus a lot on where they're going to end up in their life, something I have very little control over, but a little bit. But I think about them quite a bit. I run my life quite a bit thinking about them and the decisions I make, about what to do with my money, what jobs to take. Children play a huge role in my life, and I suspect in most parents' lives.
Indeed.
So I don't think anybody would call my decision-making myopic, short-sighted, live for the moment. Now, having children changed me, but folks with children, which there are many, tend to look forward a lot. And yet, in some areas of our lives, we don't do that. And one of those, of course, is public policy. We don't seem to do such a good job in public policy looking forward. So my question is, do you see this problem as a personal problem or a structural problem with how incentives, either for politicians or business people, have been set up? How do you see this problem that you're worried about the future? What's causing it?
I do think it's a problem of the system, a structural problem, as you're suggesting, because, as you say, many of us are parents and think about the future, and we actually go to some lengths to plan our affairs so that we leave an inheritance. We educate our children. We do clearly plan carefully for the future in that sense. So I think it's not an individual issue, but a structural one. And I think it's partly a question of not being aware of the implications of some decisions. And the issue of social security, pensions, welfare in the European countries is quite a good example of that. Because I'm not aware of any government that actually counts and publishes the figures on what its obligations to future generations are under the structures we have at the moment.
They're
very large numbers. For the US, Larry Kotlikoff has estimated 200 trillion, very, very large numbers that put into the shade the actual figures for debt that we look at in the published statistics. And I think measuring some kind of national balance sheet is actually a really important step on the way to framing a longer-term perspective for public policy. I mean, in a sense, I think politicians need some ammunition to help them make longer-term decisions because the short-term pressures are so intense. And that's the pressures of partisan politics, which on the one hand is a terrific thing because it's part of the vibrancy of democracy, but on the other hand, it puts a lot of weight on satisfying short-term interest groups, as Nancy Olsen famously pointed out in his work. And there's also the relentless pressure of the media in the 24-hour, every-minute communication age. So I think it's really difficult in public life to have a long-term perspective. I think measuring better and publishing statistics is a really important part of the ammunition to start chipping away at that.
Yeah, that's a great – it's one of your themes in the book is the importance of measurement and what we measure. What's troubling is that, as you point out, there are a lot of public voices that have exposed some of the hidden costs that have – that we're going to face. I mean, there's a few of them, as you point out. There's Social Security. There's retirement promises. There's health promises. In the United States, it's Medicare. There are public pensions, which are increasingly in the news here in the United States in March of 2011. So a lot of public employees have been promised fixed amounts of money that actually – they're fixed, but some of them rise with inflation, with fixed costs of living. And no money's been set aside, or not enough money's been set aside. So that number is also alleged to be in the trillions down the road. There are the promises that we have made, and you talk about these in the book, of debt to pay back future creditors from loans that we have taken out in the present. So there appears to be a train wreck coming, a really bad train wreck of promises not able to be kept. So one way to prevent that, of course, as you suggest, is to publish what the promises are. But we do kind of know about them. So I wonder if the problem isn't more a unpleasantness to put off till tomorrow what we think we might be able to.
I'm sure that's in operation. It's kind of human nature, isn't it, that problems do have to be pressing and crises do have to be quite serious for people to do anything about them. I mean, if you just think about the financial crisis and how serious that was, and in a way you could argue that relatively little has changed despite the intensity of the crisis. So I do think that's true. But I've been wondering also, and I write about this as well in the book, about the sort of public morality, the sense of shared values and shared commitment to society. And I look back often to the Victorians and how they thought about the future. I travel a lot to Manchester here in the UK. It's a city whose heyday was in the Victorian era. And it's a great example of the way the people who built two generations worth of dynamic economic growth at the same time thought about their legacy 100 years from now. And we're still using the buildings, the sewage systems, the railway systems, all of that infrastructure that they put in place. We've been living on it ever since. And I've sort of given up the habit of thinking about the permanence of our societies and possibility of progress and what legacy we're going to leave for future generations.
Well, I had a guest on, Matt Ridley, And he, this was a few months back, he made the observation that it's rather bizarre to think about what generations 50 and 100 years will need from now. Yes, there's certain basic responsibilities that are a good idea, but those Manchesterians, is that what we call them, by the way?
They have, Mancunians.
Mancunians. I knew they had an interesting name for American economists named Greg Mankiw. It must be a very strange thing to think about Mancunians being not people in favor of a Pigovian tax on carbon, but rather people from the city of Manchester. But Mancunians, people in Manchester, they did provide some basic things that were fortunately were still able to use. But they, of course, had no idea what our lives would be like. So one view says it's really preposterous, maybe even hubris, to think we can plan for the future at that level. But certainly there is planning that's a good idea. And I would say one of the most basic things we should plan to do is not to be irresponsible. So that would seem to be a modest level of planning that we're not doing a very good job on.
But, I think the definition that I like as the minimum ambition is making sure that the next generation to come along can be at least as well off in its living standards and quality of life as your generation. So in other words, not eating the different kinds of capital that make the economy tick.
Yeah. Well, it's going to be interesting to see if we've done that. Whoever, you know, I hate to say we, because there is no we here. There's no coordinated consensus activity. That they're just emergent phenomena that may burden or help the next generation. But I want to go back to something you said a minute ago that's another theme of the book, which is the issue of social fabric, trust, and so on. Another way to think about this is culture. Not in the sense of the arts, but what we think of as corporate culture, what we think of as, you know, family culture, what we think of is what it means to be a good citizen, a good neighbor. And I want to make a claim, and I want you to react to it. My claim is that Adam Smith believed that capitalism made us better people. I don't think that view is widely held anymore. I still believe in it, and I would argue that much of what we see is the breakdown of trust and responsibility. What we see is an increase in corruption, pursuit of self-interest is coming from bad public policy rather than inherent to the world of commerce. What do you think of that claim?
I have a lot of sympathy with that. I, too, am a tremendous fan of capitalism. I do think capitalism works well in the context of a certain kind of society. And I think we've seen plenty of examples around the world of countries where capitalism has been introduced without the sort of benefits for essentially freedom and the consequences of the living standards that we've seen in the West. And I guess the great experiment in that respect, which will prove or disprove a lot of theories, is communist China. And we'll see whether the capitalism can work without the fabric of a democracy and a liberal society. But having said that, I think the kind of, at least the sense of progress and shared effort that characterized capitalism in its early days helped deliver the growth and the freedoms that we all enjoy now. And that's the kind of thing that has started to corrode a bit, I think. If you're looking at the role of public policy in that, well, it's pretty complicated to disentangle, but I think it's really hard to argue now that certain welfare systems that many Western economies have had have actually damaged the very people they were trying to help. They've trapped people in certain places and without the ability to connect to the labor market and better their lives and improve the lot of their children. I don't really think, even on the left or progressive side of politics, there is a lot of serious dispute about that fact now.
Yeah. What I was thinking about, I was, you know, thinking about your remarks about the Victorians. I want to bring it to the financial crisis and get your take on this this idea, which is, you know, Wall Street right now in America, and I'd be interested in a British perspective in terms of, say, the London financial markets, if there's a similar feeling. But in America today, Americans look at Wall Street and see it as a very unhealthy culture, heavily materialistic, no regard for the well-being of the people who are allegedly being served. So this relentless pursuit of profit, which encouraged the creation of mortgage-backed securities, the derivatives they were based on, that were based on them, and led to this frenzy of maniacal investing that just collapsed ultimately with horrible costs for everyone other than Wall Street. And so I think Americans look at that and they say, well, this is capitalism run amok. And my counterpoint to that is that in the 1980s and 1970s and 1960s and even into the 90s a little bit, when investment banks were private partnerships, they didn't act like that. There was a very different ethos among those folks. And they, when they went public and could play with other people's money, they became more reckless. And when the other people's money they were playing with turned out to be taxpayer money, it's not surprising that they were particularly reckless. I suspect – well, so what I'm wondering is that culture I think is endogenous. Do you think that's true in the UK? Do you think this story I'm telling has any merit in terms of the endogeneity?
I think so. I think it's a bit more complicated, though, so let me explain. There's certainly the same sense amongst the general public that greed has run amok in the City of London as well. They see people whose banks are owned by the taxpayer, or majority owned by the taxpayer, paying themselves multi-million pound bonuses. This is time when the Bank of England is still subsidising the costs, the funding costs of the banking system here to the tune of £100 billion a year.
Same thing here.
And banks made a £40 billion profit.
Yep.
So despite the massive subsidy, they're still not making profit, and they're rewarding themselves for supposed success. And in a context of really quite severe public spending cuts, with services and jobs going in the public sector, there is complete outrage. Do you say people think this is capitalism that's gone wrong? I think it's more to do with the fact that, on the one hand, the governance of banks has been weak, and on the other hand, there's not enough competition in many financial markets, retail and wholesale financial markets. So the people who run the banks have been able to extract those economic rents from their shareholders on the one hand and their customers on the other, and then, as you point out, now the taxpayers as well. So I would argue that there's nothing like a free market, actually, or a healthy market in the banking system, and that's what needs to be addressed. I think also the point you raise about ownership structures is very interesting. If we had very strong governance on behalf of shareholders, then the public ownership wouldn't matter. The fact there were public listed companies wouldn't matter so much. But if we don't have good governance, then I think a partnership is actually a much better structure disciplining the activities and the risk-taking of the investment banks.
Yeah, I think that's a neglected aspect of the crisis, because it preceded the crisis, but I think it sowed the seeds. And my claim, which is merely consistent with the facts, it's not a proof, but my claim is that the growth in publicly traded investment banks was a response to the bailouts that we saw in the United States starting around 1984 with Continental Illinois, and through the Mexican crisis in 1995, the savings and loan crisis. And I think a lot of investment banks realized they could tap into that expectation of creditor bailout. That's a speculation without much evidence.
I think I'd agree with your speculation. I mean, in effect, we're saying that moral hazard is a much more serious problem than has been realized as these successive crises unfolded. And that is that word moral coming back into the debate again.
Yeah, that's right. It's a funny word, isn't it, in that phrase, but it does suggest something more fundamental going wrong.
Yeah.
Is there a lot of – in the United States, one of the sources of that outrage that you mentioned in the UK is the it's sometimes called the revolving door. A lot of people from investment banks end up sprinkled throughout the regulatory structure and the decision-making structure of Treasury and the Federal Reserve, and it's a very unhealthy synergy, in my opinion and in most people's opinion. of course, those are the people who understand how markets work, supposedly. So it's natural that they would move back and forth between regulatory and investment bank activity. But I find it's very disturbing. And an example I always refer to is that I think it was the week or two before the AIG bailout, the rescue, Hank Paulson, the Secretary of the Treasury, spoke with Lloyd Blankfein, the CEO of Goldman Sachs, who was his successor as CEO. They talked 24 times on the phone. They didn't talk about their kids and summer activities. They talked about probably what AIG meant to Goldman Sachs or maybe to the world. But from the perspective of Lloyd Blankfein, they were sort of similar. So one of the things I think that people are really upset about, and I am, is the political influence of the investment banks. Is that problem – is there a similar problem in the UK and similar outrage?
I think it's certainly similar in the sense that the financial elite is a pretty narrow circle of people and they would all know each other. I think it's really hard for regulators to actually capture all the information that they would have needed anyway to understand really what was going on. It was a really quite rare individual who had spotted exactly what the problem was in the build-up to the crisis and therefore could diagnose exactly what regulatory steps to take. And, you know, even afterwards, I think there's a wide range of explanations for what happened, and it's quite hard to pin the blame on any single one of them. So I have sympathy with the regulators as well, even though I do agree with you that they're too close, they have been too close to the banking industry. I do have some sympathy for the task, because if the boards of the banks, if the non-executive directors of the banks didn't actually know what was going on, then it's really hard for an external body to have access to the information they would have needed as well. And that, too, puts the emphasis back on the way that you conduct your own business and how genuinely you think you need to serve your shareholders and serve your customers. And when I've spoken to the kind of eminent senior bankers in London who are now dignified chairmen, so that the prime of their career in the banking industry was in the 70s and 80s, they have been quite horrified and embarrassed about the way they see their successors behaving.
The problem I have with that, the sympathy thing, and I have that, I don't mean to suggest, although I've been very critical on this program about the behavior of the people like Hank Paulson and Ben Bernanke, it's of course easy to sit in this chair in Fairfax, Virginia and take pot shots at them. They were scared. I don't think they malevolently sat around and figured out how to exploit taxpayers. I think they were genuinely scared. But I think the issue is, who's got the incentive to be prudent? And politicians and regulators will never have that incentive because it's not their money. It should be. We should try to create a system where the banks have the incentive to be prudent because they're the ones closest to the information and the money. And when you have a system where that's not true, you should expect nothing but disaster. So although I'm, you know, sympathetic at some kind of personal level, I don't think Hank Paulson or Ben Bernanke or Alan Greenspan are malevolent, evil people. I do think the system, it didn't give them an incentive to be careful. So I
would also go back to the competition point. A lot of people are kind of scared of competition. They don't see the point of it. And I spent 8 years on the competition authority here in the UK, and people would say to me, well, we don't want competition in healthcare, actually. We just want the one that we have to work. Yeah. And they don't understand the dynamic effect of competition in serving customers and encouraging innovation. And if you think about the lack of the innovation in some areas and lack of it in others in banking, it's quite revealing, because all of the innovation that I can see, and people say it's an incredibly innovative industry, but all of it that I can see was in creating complexity and instruments that didn't really have any purpose to serve customers. It was all for the purpose of the industry itself. And that with what happened in Kenya, where a mobile phone company was kind of able to persuade the banking authorities that it could offer, in effect, a banking scheme on mobile phones. And now a very large proportion of the Kenyan population, which previously had no access to financial services at all, can transfer money, pay bills, pay in shops, buy insurance through through text messages on their mobiles, which is a fantastic customer-facing innovation. We can't do it in the UK. The banks are doing mobile services that are, in effect, offering the same services to the customers they already have through a different means, but they're not actually innovating to serve their customers.
That's a great, great example. And when you talk about the alleged innovation, which I'm ashamed to say I've defended before I thought more about it and understood it better, because it does look innovative, the financial instruments, the mortgage-backed securities. And of course, there are many mainstream and very thoughtful people, at least seemingly thoughtful people, who want us to go back and do – we've got to have that again. There are people who defend that innovation. But as you point out, I think securitization, which is very clever, was mainly used as a way to comply with regulatory strictures – and yet still make a lot of money, which is what I'd expect them to do. Again, that's not surprising. But we shouldn't glorify it as innovation that serves the customer.
On the contrary, it gave mortgages to people who couldn't afford them. So it was disserving customers.
Yeah. It reminds me of the innovation of agricultural regulations in the United States. Unbelievably opaque, impossible for an outsider to understand, and mainly designed to serve a very small group of people and make them very rich. Very distressing. So
regulation of that kind actually creates barriers to entry.
Absolutely.
One of the main reasons there are no new banks is because complying with the financial regulation is too high a barrier.
You mentioned, and we talked about this in your previous appearance, the competition authority. Is that the equivalent in the UK of the antitrust division in the United States? Do you know? What does it do?
Yes,
what does it do?
At the moment, we have two. We have the Office of Fair Trading, which is a gatekeeper authority. It will refer serious issues to the Competition Commission, which puts together panels of five members, and I was one of those members, to look at particular mergers or particular markets where there are problems.
So are there innovations in policy that you think are being missed that might make competition occur more naturally?
Well, I would really love there's an inquiry into the banking industry taking place here at the moment due to report in the spring. I would dearly love it to say there should be a full competition assessment of the banking industry in the UK. I fear they won't go that far. But I think a competition assessment that looked really at barriers to entry and whether or not new entrants, including mobile phone companies, for goodness sake, if they want to, if that's possible, that would be my preferred route.
So let me ask you a tough personal question, which you're free to duck and divert into any direction you want.
Okay.
You're on this – let's say one – a person, not you. A person is on that competition committee. Just like we have these – we have certainly regulatory agencies in the United States that deal with similar things. We also, of course, have legislation that tries to reform, so-called reform the banking system. What kind of pressures do you think those folks are under to do something other than, quote, the right thing? That is, right now in the United States, we passed something called Dodd-Frank, a bill that's supposed to improve the financial system. The strangest thing about it is a lot of it's unwritten. It's going to be written down the road by various agencies. Of course, those agencies – people are going to be paying a lot of attention when those regulations get written are the banks. most of us, the regular folk, are not going to pay any attention. Oh, that bill already passed. So I wouldn't be optimistic about how that's going to turn out just on normal incentive grounds. And then I ask, well, how does that process actually work? I don't think the people on the commission get a phone call that says, hey, I'm with such and such bank. Do what's good for me and there'll be a check in the mail. So that doesn't happen. There isn't bribery. But there must be subtle forms of pressure that take place. Do you have any thoughts on that?
I think the biggest pressure is the fear of saying something radical, actually, or recommending something that seems just an extraordinarily dramatic step to take given where we're starting from. So my one possible solution to my problem of banks being having too much monopoly power would be to say they're too big. They should be broken up into smaller banks. We have four high street lenders and deposit takers. We need, through a process of mergers over the years, over 25 years, those mergers need reversing. We need, I don't know, 6, 8 high street banks instead. That's quite a radical thing for any individual to say. I think actually you need a lot of confidence. So maybe it's my own hubris that makes it possible for me to think that a competition body ought to be able to say that. But I think that's a hard step to take.
Right, and if somebody put forward such a proposal, and the same thing would happen in the United States, people would say, well, that's un-American. And it might be, by the way. I'm not sure I'm in favor of it, but I'm just thinking of I'm not in favor of that being the best way to solve the problem for sure. But if we're going to keep bailing out banks with taxpayer money, that might be what economists will call a second best solution. It's a horrible solution, but it beats the alternative. But there'd be tremendous – you're right. There'd be a lot of intellectual pressure and personal pressure of, oh, this is too radical, it's too risky. But of course,
you could take the banks saying that's a really bad idea. You'd expect that. But I think the really hard thing would be lots of very smart people would write in the Wall Street Journal and the Financial Times telling you how stupid you were.
Yeah, that'd be awkward. but it's interesting to me that what I think happens, and this is something called Bruce Yandel's put forward called the bootlegger and Baptist theory, the idea that we have both good motives and selfish motives for what we do, and often we do the selfish thing, but we justify it with the non-selfish thing, right? So when we apply this at the personal level, so you know, you advocate for the banks, but that would be couldn't look yourself in the mirror if you advocated for the banks. So you say it's because it's bad for capitalism or it's whatever. You find it's too risky. You find a altruistic reason to explain why you're doing it, but deep down, maybe you're doing it because the banks are going to be nice to you when you're done. That's the ugly part of it. What a mess. Well,
this goes back to your point about the revolving door, which is that it feels very flattering to be part of this elite and to be one of the club. And so if you start to meet people socially and they look like they respect you and they like you and you're invited to all the posh conferences, then it's all the harder to break away from it.
Yeah, I think that's a huge part of it. I've suggested, I don't know if it's true again, it's hard to prove, you can't prove it, it's just a claim. But yeah, if you don't, for example, if you're not an interventionist, you don't get to hang out with all the interventioners, the interveners. They're not going to invite you to the party. So there's a huge, I think, corruption implicit in our profession, which is if you want to play, you got to be in favor of the game. And to say that it's a bad game, that the government ought to be out of these things, you don't get invited to the not just the posh conferences, you don't get invited to anything. You're not on the team. Let's move on to a cheerier subject. let's talk about the debt issues. You have, I just want to say to readers, to listeners, that one of the things that makes Diane's book so different and enjoyable is that she's extremely thoughtful. As you can tell from listening to her, but she's even thoughtful in print. I have some guests, Diane, who are very reasonable when I talk to them, but in their books they say very different things. So this is a case where there's a coincidence between the two. But in your book, you have very thoughtful things to say about debt. And you go and all these issues, you go through many different viewpoints, and you let the reader – you have your own views, of course, but you let the reader hear different sides of these issues. What are some of the scenarios that might play out about public debt and where we might have to end up? Where do you think we're headed and what might be done to get us to a good place?
Debt becomes a problem if the economy doesn't grow fast enough that there'll be enough to pay it in the future. So one pessimistic scenario is that the only way to prevent countries like ours getting trapped by debt where the real interest rate is high enough that it just keeps building up and never shrinks is by very dramatic cuts in government spending or increases in taxation. And that, of course, is what the UK government is doing. I think probably uniquely amongst the larger economies, although obviously Ireland and Greece in their sovereign debt crises are having to act in the same way as well. But a more optimistic or more comfortable path would be if we can grow the economy faster. And the trouble is that raising long-term productivity growth has proven to be quite a hard thing to do. And through the 1990s and early 2000s, we saw the impact of the communications revolution on productivity growth in the US. I haven't seen any updates of the long-term estimates lately, but it's hard to believe that we could achieve the same again because we've had the communications revolution and it's still playing out. It's not obvious that the growth is going to improve. But if it did, that would be terrific. Growing the economy would be fantastic. There are alternatives too. If the problem is pensions and older people who are not working, claiming on Medicaid and equivalent systems here, then maybe people should work longer. Maybe we can have innovations in health that means that they lead more productive lives for longer and can stay in the labor force. There are lots of countries where there are still large groups of unemployed people, especially young people, where a large portion of women don't go out to work. And if you get those people working productively, you can raise the growth rate. So there are other options. They can play out in other ways. It doesn't have to be we must cut back now. But if we're not going to cut back now, then governments need to give a lot more thought to how to increase the productivity of the economy.
Well, let's divide this into two parts. One, the debt itself, and the second, the promises, the programmatic promises, either through pensions or retirement programs like Social Security. Let's just start with the debt itself. And I want to get your take on what's going on in England right now. Our perception over here is that England, as you say, has perhaps uniquely taken a very different step. They've cut spending, very ironic, in the land of Keynes. They've cut spending is the impression we have because they believe that even if that had a short-term negative effect, which is I'm not sure that's true. I'm a skeptic about Keynesian economics, but even if that's true, the risks down the road of excessive debt are so large that it's worth it to do that in the short run so that in the medium or longer run that the system will be healthier. In the United States, we're going right now in the opposite direction. We're going to run a $1.6 trillion deficit again, roughly. It's the third year in a row, I think, we've run a third or fourth year plan that will run at least a one-something trillion-dollar deficit. First, tell me what is factually going on in your country, because I do hear that there's some – that they didn't really cut. They just slowed down. Have they actually cut public spending? And two, what do you think of this argument that it's crucially necessary to avoid a worse problem of debt service?
There are cuts in public spending. The assessment is complicated by not knowing how many people are going to be unemployed, and therefore there are some automatic payments that go alongside that, so it's a little bit hard to predict. And, of course, there's the interest payment on the debt as well, which is going up. But in terms of services, this is a real significant retrenchment in the government. And I think it's partly to do with the economics, and it does seem to have had an impact on financial market perceptions of the UK. Given the level of debt and the deficit here, I'm not sure that we'd be in such a comfortable position in the financial markets if the government didn't have this program. But I think there are also deeper economic and political reasons for doing it as well, which goes back to what we were discussing a little while ago about ending the dependency on government. And I was really struck by a story I saw on the local news about a voluntary group which sends women out to help mothers who've got children, they need some support in the home, they go and help with their babies and toddlers. So they interviewed a woman who was getting help. She had triplets, she needed some respite from them, and she got a couple of hours of help a week from a volunteer. And the volunteer was another mum just like her who came along to help out. And they were arguing that if the government cut its support of voluntary agencies, then that activity would have to stop and it wouldn't go ahead. And I thought to myself, but isn't that what friends and family do for each other? And what is the role of the government in this? And I think it's that kind of assumption that nothing can happen without the government making it happen that is also being addressed by the kind of cuts that have in the UK. And they don't articulate it all that clearly. There's this phrase, the big society, and that's generally taken to mean the voluntary sector must do things instead of the government doing things. I think it's subtler than that. I think it's rebuilding some of the self-reliance that has actually evaporated over the past couple of generations.
Yeah, it's a fascinating example. I think let me ask you first a factual question. Do you know offhand roughly the size of government spending as a function of the economy as a whole?
42% or so.
So we're at 20.
I can't quite the exact figure, but it's around there.
So in the United States, we're at 25 right now, 26, way up from 3 years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, when it was more like 20, which has sort of been the peacetime percentage of the United States has hovered around 20. And for reasons that perhaps aren't so understood, it's been very difficult to raise more than 20%. Despite changes in tax rates, the percentage that the government collects doesn't seem to go much above 20. So if you persistently raise – if you persistently spend 26, that gap's going to be a very unpleasant thing down the road. But the UK is at 42. Couldn't the U.S. just raise our taxes? And couldn't we solve our problem by going to – that's austerity in the UK, right? 42.
Well, if it goes down to 40 and below, which is the aim, that will be austerity in the UK.
Sort of.
It's always proven very hard to reduce. Mrs. Thatcher had a really good go, and she sort of leveled off the proportions around 40% for a while, and then it started to climb again.
But isn't that strange?
And I think that reflects political choices, really. We like to have our healthcare provided through the government. It's a really popular system in the UK, and that's a decent proportion of the total. And the majority of people go to state-funded schools as well. So that's another significant proportion.
Well, we like to pretend
and
that we...
In France and Sweden, they like it to be even higher. They like their government to do even more. I think that's the sort of voter preference.
But here in the United States, we like to pretend that we like a private system. We don't really have it, right?
Yeah, that's a problem.
we've got this so-called free choice in healthcare, which where the government, through subsidy of employer-provided healthcare and Medicare and Medicaid, has created a system where 10 cents of every dollar is out of pocket. But we think it's a private system. It's unbelievable. Yeah, so there's a little bit of illusion there, I suspect. What do you think is going to happen in the United States with that debt? Do you think we're going to get in trouble or just keep more rolling along?
The thing that makes me uneasy about U.S. policy is that I'm just not sure that we can get out of the situation that we're in, any Western economy, without there being some pain. And banking crises on this scale, I mean, any banking crisis, but on this scale, they are really serious shocks to the economy. And, of course, we had a recession, but there is a perception that the government can fix it so that it's not all that long and deep. And I'm just not sure that it won't stack up a worse problem in the future by not addressing the deficit now. So that's my concern about it.
I have the
and
same
of course,
concern.
You understand that people would like there not to be such high unemployment, and that's the greatest economic evil. One could completely understand that.
Yeah. So why are you worried about that deficit? What's the sequence of events that alarms you? Because the other side says, no, we need to keep running the deficit because that stimulates the economy. I don't agree, but that's the claim. And we can keep paying we'll pay the debt off. Like we'll grow. It's a free lunch. Why are you worried?
Because the lesson of history suggests to me that the growth won't happen, and what we'll get instead is inflation. So when I had figured out that the payment system wasn't going to dry up and I didn't need all the cash, I checked out through the ATMs at the height of the crisis, I put it all in index-linked bonds instead.
Because you're worried about inflation.
Yeah.
I did something similar, by the way. I thought that was a very good thing, was to put more money into indexed securities. Of course, they're government securities here in the United States, some of them, which is maybe not the best way to avoid the problem. But
I think a lot of people must feel the same way if you look at the way many investors have piled into gold. And, of course, real assets like that always appreciate at a time when people fear inflation ahead.
So do you think that's going to happen? Do you think we're going to get hyperinflation? And by hyperinflation, I would say I'm not Zimbabwean levels, but say double digits and maybe rising.
It wouldn't surprise me to see 70-style levels of inflation again. We have the commodity price push, and we have the monetization going on. And I just don't see any examples in history that not leading to inflation of 15, 20, maybe 25%. And, you know, that might not sound too bad, but compared to Zimbabwe, but it's incredibly corrosive. And I remember growing up in the 1970s in a family where both parents worked, but on incomes that just didn't keep up, didn't keep pace with inflation. And things got tighter and tighter. My mother would stockpile anything that she saw on sale because she wouldn't be able to afford it in 6 months' time. It's an incredibly damaging phenomenon. And I think economists who say a bit of inflation doesn't matter, you know, if it's 5%, they're right. But if it starts going up, I think they really underestimate the social cost.
Yeah, I think economists weren't worried about it, either too young or I think lack of imagination. But it's a bit scary, I agree. Well, let's turn to something more cheerful.
You keep saying that, but we seem not to find cheerful things to talk about.
I know, but I'm going to try again. Let's talk about things, what might be done. So we've talked about one of the ideas in the book, which is measurement. So go into a little more detail about what measurement improvements we might make, and then let's turn to other things we might do to cope with the mess we're in.
Well, I divide the measurement improvements into two categories, really. One is to have a sort of national balance sheet as well as looking at GDP and growth, to look at the stocks as well as the flows, because I think then automatically that gives you that longer time frame that we were discussing earlier, because you'll know if you're eating into the resources that are available in the future, even if it looks like the economy is doing really well today. And the other category is looking at a wider range of indicators than we typically do to characterize economic success. And I'm not one of those who advocates ditching GDP. I think it's actually a really important indicator. And there are some, particularly environmentalists, who say it's no guide to our well-being. I completely disagree with that. So I think we need to keep it, but we should supplement it with a range of other things. And actually, I've just been reading a very interesting book by Charles Kenny called Getting Better, where he looks at indicators of well-being in developing countries. And there are only two countries where GDP per capita has gone down and other indicators of well-being like life expectancy, infant mortality, education levels haven't gone up. And the two countries that fail on both counts are Zimbabwe and Zambia, so two basket case economies. But on other fronts, things have been getting better around the world. And you just get a much broader perspective of how well people's lives are going, I think, if you supplement looking at GDP with looking at other indicators of well-being. And we do that to an extent. We look at unemployment, which is a really important one, but there are others. In Australia, the authorities ask people what they think is important, and they collect those every year. There's an annual publication called Measuring Australia's Progress, and I think that would be a really good innovation in other countries too.
What kind of things come out on that list that are surprising or useful?
I don't think they're surprising. I think what it tells you is the priorities and therefore what politicians need to respond to if they're going to try and intervene in any way. Hmm. And they range from how nice the parks look and the quality of the environment, the air quality in the city, congestion. Actually, people really hate congestion and getting stuck in traffic.
Yes, they do.
That's a big one, which is kind of interesting. It's not necessarily a high policy priority. So it's interesting that everybody says that they think it's really diminishes the quality of their life.
Well, one thing that's important about congestion is that the roads are publicly owned. So at least the government, in theory, could do something about it. They could, of course, make mistakes. But a lot of the things I think people are worried about, they hope the government could do something about, but they actually can't, or they can't do it very successfully, or it leads to other things. But you know, the roads, at least, they're run by the government, so you could imagine them doing something about them. So that's not a bad thing to think about. Whether they do the right thing, if we paid more attention to it, it's a different matter. Right here in Washington D.C., traffic is horrific. There's some discussion of adding some kind of toll roads on the busiest roads, which I have mixed feelings about. That's a long other story. But at least, you know, if we collected the data on the average commute, maybe it would put more pressure on the government. I don't know. I think we do collect.
I would favor more experimentation in public policy. And one of the downsides of kind of democratic politics that we have is that governments seem to think they have to go wholly for one thing, do it all at once, and never change, never reverse course, never do a U-turn. Wouldn't it be fantastic to say, well, we'd like to see whether road tolls really work in practice, so let's have schemes in three cities for 5 years, and then we'll evaluate them and see.
Yeah, what a novel idea. Or let's do it for 6 months in one city and see if people like it or don't like it and what they don't like about it, and let's measure the impact. And yeah, there's very little of that. It's, okay, we're now going to have a toll, and it's going to last forever.
Exactly. That's, and then if you change your mind, you're humiliated.
Yeah. That is a huge issue, by the way, the unwillingness to admit a mistake among – it's a human frailty. I'm not sure it should surprise us that politicians are not good at it, but it's remarkable to me how hard it is for a politician to say, I made a mistake. This was wrong. Let's not do it again. Or let's stop doing it now even. They're not even good at that. What else? Give us some other suggestions. The measurement's one issue. What else do you think would make solve some of these problems?
Well, the other thing I'd like to think about is getting the public more involved in some of these difficult decisions and trade-offs. Because, you know, economists, to a much lesser extent, but the politicians certainly, try to pretend that there are no trade-offs and that they can fix everything for everybody. And given that we live in democracies with very vigorous media and all the online comments as well, the only way of getting out of that will be to work out how to engage voters much more directly in the thought process that goes into working out the limitations of public policy and the trade-offs that there are. And I don't have a single method that I think will work, but I think, like here again, experimentation with things ranging from citizen juries to public consultations to presenting data visualized effectively online, any of those things that try to get more of a reasoned public conversation going will be very important if we want to make any progress.
Of course, one of the challenges is we don't have much of an incentive to pay much attention.
No.
Or to be
and
careful.
It doesn't need everybody to pay attention. I think it needs a kind of core of a certain number of people who will pay attention, and then that will get sorted out.
That's true.
Through the mass media to the wider public.
That's true. One view is to make it more entertaining. I think if we paid as much attention to politics as we do to sports, we'd probably have much better public policy. One of the virtues of partisanship is that it turns – I'm not a big fan of partisanship, particularly political partisanship. I don't mind – I like principles, but the idea of my party being the thing I care most about is I find bizarre in America, but it's very common. But one of the virtues of that is that it gets people to pay attention. They get some more involved. Of course, they self-select and they choose the stream of information that confirms their biases, so I'm not sure it really works very well. It's kind of like saying my sports team's always the best team. There's lots of evidence to the contrary, but I manage to persist in my view of it often despite the evidence. So I'm not sure that would really be a good thing in politics.
I'm a bit of a statistics anorak, and I really like to look at the data visualization techniques that are available now. And I think there are ways of presenting the kind of measurements that we were talking about earlier in really visually forceful ways. And that's now being applied to the financial markets, but we could think about ways to, you know, present the debt figures or present the figures on growth and all these other indicators we're talking about. And, you know, if you can show a trade-off in a picture, that's going to be much more effective. So I'm a big fan of this kind of experimentation.
That's a great idea. Let's come full circle. We started the conversation with really what's the underlying theme of your book, which is an insufficient focus on the future, either in policy terms or personal decision-making, a failure of prudence, an emphasis on the short term over the longer term. Measurement would help with that, right? It might make it clear what the costs are down the road. Any other thoughts on how we might encourage responsibility and good behavior? With respect to the future, particularly.
The other thing is the moral question that we keep circling around. And actually, possibly also, the idea of progress. And in the United States and the United Kingdom, we used to be ardent believers in progress, that one generation would be better off than next. The American dream is all about the potential for bettering yourself and your children's lives. And I think we sort of lost faith in the idea. And it's a question of, I don't know what the word is, it's not ideology, but ideas and moral values. And politicians in this country, at any rate, I think less so in your country, tend not to talk about that. It's seen as a somewhat embarrassing thing. But I would love to see the Prime Minister here step out and say that the bankers have been immoral and that we need a stronger sense of values in society. I think the time might be right for that. This sense that there is a crisis, a sense of unease, I think is pretty widely shared. People would differ widely in their diagnoses and specific solutions, but I think the sense that something has gone awry is widely shared.
Yeah, I agree with that. I just don't think I'm not sure I want to get exhortation from my president or my prime minister. I think I'd rather get it from my family and my religious leaders and authors and other folks, even economists maybe. I'm not optimistic about the incentives that political leaders face to say those things well and in effective ways.
Do you agree? Well, I certainly wouldn't confine it just to political leaders. I do think it's a wider question of leadership. And actually, corporate leaders may well be just as important.
Yeah, that is – there are a few who are out there and who before the crisis were worried about just the issue of culture and morality.
One interesting one who's spoken out recently is Paul Polman of Unilever, who on an investor conference call was asked what was going to happen to the share price short term. He said this company's been around for 100 years and it's going to be around for another 100 years. So if you're welcome to invest in us, but if you care more about next quarter's share price, you might not be interested in doing so.
He's an optimist in some dimension, at least, that he's going to be around in 100 years. That's bold.
Yeah, indeed. But I like that.
Yeah, I do too. Anything in closing you want to add?
Well, I'm really pleased that you described the book as thoughtful, because I don't think I know all the answers. And, you know, I don't have a silver bullet solution at the end of the book. But I would love to get people thinking about some of these issues, whether they agree with what I say or not.
My guest today has been Diane Coyle. Diane, thanks for being part of EconTalk.
It's been a real pleasure talking to you. Thank you.
This is EconTalk, part of the Library of Economics and Liberty. For more EconTalk, go to econtalk.org, where you can also comment on today's podcast and find links and readings related to today's conversation. The sound engineer for EconTalk is Rich Goyette. I'm your host, Russ Roberts. Thanks for listening. Talk to you on Monday.